Okay, well, good afternoon. It's a real pleasure to be invited here. Very prestigious forum, this particular symposium, and I have so many excellent friends and colleagues over the years here. So it's great to have received this invitation. And I'm going to talk today about, I should mention a lot of my work now is associated with things at the micron dimension. I didn't want to get all mixed up in IIN with micron dimensions. So, but they all seem to be associated with proteins, and proteins are indeed wonderful nano devices. I call them pioneer, and I guess if you say they're a billion years old, yes, they are pioneering nano devices. So we'll talk about how we can use proteins here. And in particularly, I'm going to focus on a subject that most biochemists, for example, or molecular biologists would sort of ignore, and that's proteins at interfaces. And so we're going to talk a little about the importance, significance of proteins at interfaces, a bit of history. There's a lot of history coming up in this particular symposium, and I find it quite interesting. Some analytical tools and some examples, and I have this quote from a tribute to Galileo, measure what is measurable and make measurable what is not. And a lot of what I want to talk about today is how we can measure some things on nanoscale constructs at a interface with certain precision. So I'm going to start here. It's not exactly proteins, but it is sort of a biosystem. And let's see, I guess I have a laser pointer here. These are STM images taken many, many years ago, looking at this particular molecule, mercaptopurine, closely related to one of the DNA bases, a purine base. So let's see. The experiment was we have a gold 111 surface, and the mercaptopurine solution was placed on the gold 111 surface. And what we watched at 6 hours, you could see these molecules of mercaptopurine. If you look at the dimensions, they're probably single molecules of mercaptopurine adsorbing to the surface. By 18 hours, they're starting to form patterns. And by 24 hours, the mercaptopurine molecules spontaneously coalesced into a perfect two-dimensional crystal, which one can see down here. And that got me thinking about a number of things, this experiment, the spontaneity and the ability to form these highly organized structures spontaneously were very interesting to me. And let's see, I guess. In the slides. So I got to thinking about maybe in some primeval sea splashing against rocks on the shore a couple of billion years ago on this planet. And maybe there would be some lightning from the sky that would come down and add some energy to the system. And many people think that one of the origins of life might be how these primordial organic molecules in this sea organized itself spontaneously on mineral faces, maybe freshly cleaved from a volcanic eruption. So there's actually a whole community out there looking for the things about the origin of life and talking about how surfaces can orient and structure and maybe organize the complex biological systems. Another place one can look when one starts thinking about this organization is these insidious creatures we call viruses, which have a superbly organized a protein shell around them, capsid as it's known, and that organized protein layer is probably why they're so capricious and malicious and can do their virus things so effectively. It's a brilliant use of proteins. So humans made up, I've seen a number of estimates, 50 to 100,000 proteins. I found another estimate of 1 million proteins that might make up a human, but we have a lot of different proteins within us. And the protein signals within our body are delivered in this, I call it an ordered and organized fashion. So again, for the implications, the importance of this work, I do believe proteins and interfaces are important. Maybe that's where life came from, the origin of life. But in more modern systems, the medical diagnostics use proteins and interfaces with great precision. We'll talk a good bit about biocompatibility in medical devices. talk about bacterial adhesion. Well, maybe not so much in this talk, but bacterial adhesion is mediated by these interfacial proteins. The whole bioprocessing industry, a multi-billion-dollar industry now, depends upon proteins and interfaces, for particularly for cell culture systems. So there's a lot of implications for this. And then finally, proteins are small, maybe 3 to 10 nanometers, and we can ask how we can measure and study them. And how can we control and use the proteins and interfaces will be part of this. So let me go over a little history. And I like to sometimes think of the history not of nanotechnology, but of biointerface science, which really does mostly concern itself with nanostructures and interfaces. You can go all the way back to Ben Franklin. Ben Franklin placed a lipid, an organic oil layer, it was olive oil, really, on a pond in England, and actually determined the dimensions of molecules based upon that particular experiment. I think it was one of the earliest experiments in looking at a biointerface. And then Agnes Pockels, who declared herself to be a simple housewife while taking care of her convalescing father and brother, did experiments in her kitchen sink and actually had Michael Faraday publish her observations on interfacial films in the sink. I think the whole field was probably put into its proper perspective by the work of Irving Langmuir and Catherine Blodgett. And of course, we know the so-called Langmuir-Blodgett films. Talking about the biointerface, the people that brought us, I think, are really introduced to the world, molecular biology, were, of course, Linus Pauling, and then Watson and Crick, which changed totally the way we looked at biology. Richard Feynman, of course, as many people attribute nanotechnology to him. And finally, Binning and Rohr brought to us one of the classic tools, starting with the scanning tunneling microscope and then going to the atomic force microscope. So again, I like to pay sort of an homage to Irving Langmuir for his superb contributions. And while we're talking about contributions, should of course congratulate Fraser Stoddart on his Nobel Prize, but Irving got it quite a few years before that for his work, for his seminal work on surfaces and interfaces. Okay, we can also talk about some of the surface analytical tools. And interestingly, Manas Siegbahn won a Nobel Prize in 1925 for ESCA spectroscopy. And then his son, Kai Siegbahn, won the Nobel Prize in 1981 for developing what has become one of the foundation tools we now have for studying interfaces, namely the technique called ESCA, electron spectroscopy for chemical analysis. A lot of people like to call it XPS, but Dr. Siegbahn strongly insisted it be called ESCA. And I think he used to write people a letter and say, I got the Nobel Prize. I want to call it ESCA. You call it ESCA in your paper. So those letters are kind of classic and famous now. And there's a picture of a much younger version of me actually working on a rather early ESCA system. It's kind of how I started a lot of my career. Doing work on a Hewlett-Packard ESCA system. Here's another pioneering effort in surface analysis is Alfred Benninghoven, and he's standing near his sort of first prototype of a SIMS, secondary ion mass spectrometer instrument. And below that, here is what's a modern SIMS instrument looks like. Quite a big difference, but I think most people would attribute the development and growth of SIMS as a method to Dr. Benninghoven. So we have kind of this interesting basic repertoire of surface analysis methods, and I've actually shown this slide for years, but I just realized, again, listening to the congratulations to Dr. Stoddard, that practically every one of these techniques are associated with many Nobel Prizes. So the ESCA or XPS comes from the photoelectric effect that Einstein described, and then Kai Sigma won another Nobel Prize for that. The SIMS technique really is based on mass spectrometry, so Francis Aston developed that and won a Nobel Prize, I think, in 1929 for that. The AFM, of course, the Binnig-Arora again. And we even use contact angle methods actually quite a bit for surface analysis. And that can be attributed to maybe Thomas Young, who died in 1829, well before there was a Nobel Prize. So, but I'm sure if there was, Thomas Young would have gotten a Nobel Prize for his contributions. So this is our latest instrument, the University of Washington. It just came in a few weeks ago. And it's a mass spec SIMS, or sometimes called tandem mass spec SIMS. It's a $2 million piece of gear. I think there's just five of them in the world now. And it gives us some extremely powerful new capabilities in this ability to analyze surfaces. And while we're doing the history, I really have to mention some of the people that are pioneers in the idea of proteins and interfaces, not just proteins, but, or let me just say solid interfaces, probably even more accurate, solid protein interface. And we have Leo Vroman, who's a hematologist by training, but a brilliant observer and gave us a lot of our basic phenomenology of proteins and interfaces. He's also the poet laureate, or was a poet laureate of the state of Holland. Dr. Vroman just passed away recently. And then my colleague at the University of Washington, Tom Horbitt, and John Brash at McMaster University, these three individuals, I think, put a lot of the ideas we use today of proteins and interfaces on the map. So I'm very interested in medical devices, and we sort of see two of them here. You can see an endosteous screw or a dental screw that would hold a tooth prosthesis in place. And I think the important point here is, number one, the proteins adsorb to most surfaces. And medical devices are placed into bleeding, wet sites with high concentrations in a multi-protein solution, very complex environments. The other picture is the surface of a contact lens. So if anybody's wearing contact lenses, might just worry about that. So the proteins at surfaces actually can do a bunch of quite interesting things. They can absorb or stick to the surface, or they can come off, or they can fractionate. There might be more of the green ones in the solution phase on the surface. There might be more of the orange ones. One protein can displace another. The proteins on the surface can reconform, can conform to the surface. They can orient themselves. They can come from an inactive to an active form, or they can go from an active form to an inactive form. A lot of different processes they can do. So let's just examine some problems in biomaterial science and maybe how surface technologies can contribute. So in this example, I have seven different biomaterials labeled here. I'm not going to really elaborate on them, but they're all widely used in medical devices today. And some are metal, and some are polymer, and some are hydrophobic, and some are hydrophilic. We have quite a range there. If we stick these into a protein solution, let's say blood, they can all absorb proteins. But interestingly, if you look at my cartoon, the mix of proteins on the surface of every one of these can be considerably different. And then if living cells come down and interact, these cells are going to see those proteins, and they're going to respond in different ways. In some cases, the cells will spread. In some cases, the cells will round up. In other cases, they'll become activated. So each surface absorbs different proteins, and these different proteins activate cells differently. So this leads to what I call one of the major conundrums in sort of biomaterial science. And I have, again, on this slide, I have this list of what I call nine very different materials, so similar to the other slide. And so I hand this set of materials to my graduate students, and I say, let's look at protein adsorption. And they tell me every one of these materials absorbs different proteins. We take blood platelets and put them on those materials, and every one of them interacts with platelets in a different way. Sometimes the platelet's activated, sometimes it's not, sometimes it releases its contents. We can write this neat paper on platelets and cells. Put living cells on there, and the cells grow at different rates, with different types of growth on these different surfaces. So clearly, the biology is interrogating the surface. But then I hand it to my surgeon colleague, and the surgeon colleague implants it in an animal, and all of them heal indistinguishably. What's going on here? Clearly, the proteins at the surface interrogate the biology, yet if one looks at that healing response in the long term, what the body does is basically put a wall around all those materials. Here's a scanning electron micrograph of that wall. This Teflon device is a glucose sensor. It's been in an animal for 6 weeks, and we see this dense capsule. This is what normal tissue looks like over here. See the normal tissue here. So glucose has to get from that normal tissue to that Teflon device. Can't get through that dense capsule. That's why we don't have long-term implanted glucose sensors yet, because of this reaction. The body walls it off. And it wouldn't matter if that Teflon device was any of 20 other different biomaterials. They'd all be walled off in the same way. We might conclude from that that surfaces don't matter. Why are we even studying surfaces? But I think it's not a good conclusion, because biology uses surfaces and interfaces brilliantly, and we'll talk about that in a second. And in the in vitro or out of the body situation, all biomaterials directly exploit surfaces. We see this in surface diagnostics, and we see this in cell culture and things like that. So what are biology's tricks? Well, biology does its work, its brilliant work, first of all, with complexity. Molecules are very complex. Typically, of course, we have 20 proteins. We have really thousands of potential sugars. The DNA nucleotides, of course, are hugely complicated. Biology uses complexity to go to number two, recognition. And the complexity allows very highly specific recognition. Biology also uses assembly. It puts molecules together in ordered fashions. Again, our innards may look like a bowl of goo, but actually you start looking at the molecular or nano level, and one finds very high levels of organization. Biology uses mobility. Things aren't rigid. There's a little flex, a little bit of flexibility that allows systems to settle into a let's call it an energy minimum that allows these recognition interactions to readily occur. And biology also uses optical sense, and it uses another set of properties called non-fouling or stealth, where it doesn't want things to interact. Biology is great at preventing interactions. Again, this just talks to a cell with maybe cell receptors interacting maybe with another cell membrane. Interactions can be with molecules like collagen. This is collagen, which makes, say, very interesting interactive surfaces. This has led to sort of a model for what's really happening there is the biosurface with the adsorbed proteins might send a signal into the cell, maybe through one of these integrin receptors. The signal goes to the cytoskeleton of the cell. The cytoskeleton reconforms, sends a signal to the nucleus. The nucleus might make a new messenger RNA that goes to the ribosome that leads to new proteins going off to the body. So we have a communication system from the surface itself that controls the proteins through the cell out to the body. Here's just an example. This goes back to the early 80s, but I think it shows very graphically the importance of surfaces. So what we have here, there are two columns. One's labeled ACE, and the other is B, D, and F figures. And in the ACE column, we have just ordinary polystyrene, maybe the material of this sort of clear dish or a little clear plastic box. On the other side, we have a polystyrene. Looks identical, but it has just a few percent of surface modification by a glow discharge plasma. And at 2 hours, we seed the cells on these. These are endothelial cells. And the two surfaces look pretty similar. By 6 hours, you can see on the plain polystyrene, the cells have begun to clump badly. And if you look more closely, they look kind of sick. Well, they're starting to spread and even beginning to multiply or replicate on the treated surface. And by 3 days, actually, it's very hard to see here. This was scanned out of an old thesis back when we used to do these things called photographs. But there's a confluent monolayer of cells on the treated polystyrene. And the untreated one, the cells are all dead, and it's a mess. So what's the difference between the two? The two materials absorb protein, very different protein layers. And one protein layer was totally conducive to cell growth and cell vitality. And the other layer was a disaster for cells. Very simple example, but shows very graphically how different or how important the surfaces are for the proteins. So these proteins at surfaces, what kind of information is there? Well, we can ask questions about which protein, is it this one or this one, or any of the other 10,000 proteins, really. And we can also ask questions for a given protein. If this green thing is sort of the active site, is it up, is it down? Maybe the protein's denatured. We have a bunch of questions we can ask about what that protein does at our surface and interface. So that kind of leads to the theme I'm going to be pretty much harping on the rest of this talk, which I call precision immobilization of biomolecules. And why do we want to do it? Because nature delivers protein signals that way, with precision. So the proteins are stabilized in a lipid bilayer. They're oriented in the correct direction to get the active or recognition sites most accessible to the body. Nature stabilizes and organizes proteins, and I think we have to be able to do that too. And then, just comparing our brilliant capsid of a virus to what most of our surfaces look like these days, I call them snake cages or bowls of fettuccine, is closer to what we do rather than this highly organized sort of surface. And what's wrong with these non-specific surfaces, these surfaces that glom down all these proteins? Well, again, here's this word biocompatibility. We used it earlier. And let's say that green thing is a medical implant. And so you'd ask a physician, is this biocompatible or not? And the physician might use this definition on the bottom. If the implant, the green thing, within approximately 1 month is found within this thin, relatively acellular collagenous sac. We saw the SEM of that earlier, this dense sac. The reaction site's quite quiescent. The surgeon would say, hey, that looks biocompatible. I think the FDA would say that too. But again, we have this problem is that green thing could be titanium or polyethylene or carbon or polylactic acid or platinum or alumina, and they're going to all heal just the same. So we have to be able to explain why different materials heal the same, why do all these materials that heal similarly, what do they have in common? And I think what they have in common, again, is this uncontrolled proteins on the interface. They all have proteins, but it's totally uncontrolled. It just gloms down on the surface. There's nothing in normal biology that uses anything like the mess we get at surfaces by normal materials. So nature never uses non-specific proteins. We, as the engineers, sort of have no say about what proteins are absorbed. We stick them in and they absorb stuff. And interestingly, nature does know how to routinely heal, for example, injured soft tissue without a capsule, without that scar. Nature can do it. We're having trouble doing it. So we started investigating in our UWeb center. It was an NSF-funded engineering research center. What are the molecules that do stimulate normal healing, that give us this desirable healing? And we have a whole list here. I'm not going to read it, but these were interesting clues. These are all molecules that are found in wounds, and when the wound is healed, they're gone. So the body uses these in some manner to heal the wound. So we focus much effort on these, and you'll hear about some of them in a minute or two. So our core strategy in the UWeb was, number one, if those proteins are bad news, maybe we can develop very good stealth materials that totally keep our proteins. And it took us actually 18 years to develop perfect stealth materials that we could put for 3 months in the body and not have anything absorbed to it and not see any reaction to it. And we We published that recently in Nature Biotechnology. We're able to do that. But since I want to talk about proteins and not the absence of proteins here, I'm not going to go into that part of the strategy. But on the other hand, what we do want to do is maybe encourage specific interactions, turn on specific processes, but preventing this non-specific interaction is really what we want to do. So again, here's this reaction. I've given it a name now, the foreign body reaction. We have these non-specific proteins. Some cells come down called macrophages. The macrophages see this strange protein layer and say, this is foreign, and basically lead to this encapsulation process. And we ask, what if we had an engineered protein layer? And the macrophages came down, and they said, ah, I recognize. This is self. I understand this. And led to a healed, integrated site. That's where we're aiming at. So how to deliver these ordered, organized protein signals and interfaces? And again, part of our set of tools are these methods, these analytical methods that we use for studying proteins and interfaces, and you'll see some data from them. But we found this method called static SIMS to be particularly valuable. So in the SIMS process, what we're doing here is taking a beam of primary ions, smashing it into surface, blasting off some secondary ions, and measuring with a mass spectrometer, getting a mass spectrum of these things that are blasted off the surface. What the SIMS, under appropriate conditions, gives us is very high mass resolution. The modern SIMS instruments have superb mass resolution. They have extremely high analytical sensitivity. They have very high spatial resolution, these days down to 50 nanometers or less. And then also very shallow sampling depths, 1 to 1.5 nanometers. We're just looking at the very outermost surface there. So let's just consider proteins are made of 20 amino acids. Here's a list of all 20. And essentially all the proteins we know in this world are made of various combinations of these 20 amino acids. And back in 93, we made a discovery that nobody had ever seen before. We had some good SIMS equipment. We started doing some SIMS studies of these adsorbed protein films. And interestingly, we saw, you know, we expected to see big fragments of proteins, big chunks. We never saw big fragments. What we did see was a pattern of the all the amino acids. This is the single letter code for amino acids. We saw some pattern of the amino acids. The proteins were being broken up into little parts, individual amino acids, and we could see this sort of fingerprint from the protein. So another interesting realization is that proteins have what I call faces. If you look at a protein, there might be a face here with maybe some of the red stuff and maybe some more blue stuff here, and there's a white and blue face here. These have different mixtures of amino acids at different points. So if we consider that this protein is about maybe 5 nanometers, and the SIMS probes may be 1 to 1.5 nanometers, you could see how we could just pick off different faces depending on how the protein was oriented. And so that concept led to some other papers. This is a list of all the 20 amino acids and the exact masses that we find these in SIMS. So we can accurately identify all 20 amino acids. And imagine if the protein is kind of fully native, the 1.5 nanometer, we're going to trim off a little piece of this face. The protein was fully denatured, we'd be sampling the entire protein. The protein was glommed down on the surface. And we demonstrated this could give us a lot of insights into what proteins were doing on the surface. Another issue we had to deal with is, again, this complexity issue, in that these spectra had hundreds of peaks, and often we're working with numerous samples, and then typically 3 replicates per sample. Even for a graduate student, it was quite overwhelming. They all want to graduate within 4 or 5 years. And these data sets were so massive that they took forever to analyze. So we started turning to a set of mathematical techniques called multivariate statistical methods to take these complex fingerprints and draw patterns and correlations from them. And we use these multivariate methods quite extensively now in our interpretation of these spectra. So finally, back to how we can get better protein surfaces for biomaterials for other applications. And there's a whole list of, I call it the tool chest of strategies to immobilize proteins on surfaces. And it'd be really boring if I read the list, but I'm going to just show you a few examples that I'm going to just take off that list so you'll see how this works. Kind of a simpler one, and this is data from my colleague Dave Kastner. It's not my data, but I think it illustrates very nicely the fact that one can control protein conformation at surfaces. And let's see, we have in this diagram here, we have an antibody placed into an aqueous solution on a surface. And if we just dry that down, this whole thing we believe would denature. But there's a sugar that actually comes from creatures like this tardigrade. These creatures can survive in outer space. They can survive 30 years in the desert without water. And then you add water and they reconstruct themselves. And they're actually kind of cute in a bizarre way. Use extensively this particular sugar called trehalose. So if we add, we just have aqueous solution, dry down the protein, we're going to get highly denatured protein. But what if we could surround the protein by dissolving this trehalose sugar in solution? So this is some data that shows just how well that simple strategy works to put proteins on a surface. What we have here, let's see, this is surface plasma resonance. It's a method for measuring, what we're looking at there is a change in refractive index at a surface. But if proteins absorb the refractive index, it's going to change, of course. And and what we have here is an antibody on the surface, and it's the antibody to ferritin. And then we add ferritin to the solution and watch what happens. So this is the baseline, we add ferritin, and some of the ferritin binds, but not too much for the dried protein. If we just look at this reaction in totally aqueous solution, we see you get a big response because the protein is quite native. But if we dry that protein with the trehalose protection, we can get practically the same recognition as we can get with control. Protein never dried. So that's a very simple example, but it does show the control. Now I'm going to go to one of these proteins that is involved in healing. It's called osteopontin. And as I said, you'll find that in every wound in your body, it's found in bone, originally found in bone, but it's known to be in every tissue now in the body. And it's a pretty complicated, it's not too big a protein, but it has a number of different recognition sites on it. Allow it to do protein things. And it also has this this thing called a histidine tag that we put on it. I'll be on that in a second. it's kind of a flashy diagram from one of the manufacturers, but basically what they're showing here is that one can use this nickel complex. It's a nickel tetraacetic acid type complex. That binds very specifically the histidine tag on a protein. And if we look at osteopontin and want to immobilize it, want to use it, osteopontin has actually 14 amines at the surface. We typically use amine groups as a handle to immobilize them. But if we put on one of these histidine tags very specifically at an exact site, we can tell exactly which site to immobilize that osteopontin on. And this is a very complicated slide, but it does go through two of the strategies for immobilizing chelator, this particular chelator group that forms the binding for the histidine tag. We can put it as thiols on gold. We can immobilize it directly to a synthetic polymer. I don't want to go too much detail there. And then the SIMS, interestingly, can show the difference actually very clearly. This is called a scores plot. It's part of a partial least squares, PLS, measurement and multivariate measurement. And what we see here is the signals from the mass spec fractionate into the oriented, we can see here, the oriented immobilization using the HIST tag. If we do random immobilization, we see a different kind of surface structure. We can go in and analyze the mass spec signals. In fact, we always do that to find out what is contributing to giving us this separation, shows the difference. So is there significance to this? Well, again, this is another quite complicated experiment, but one of the things osteopontin does in the body is prevent large hydroxyapatite crystals from forming. So hydroxyapatite's the mineral of your bone, and if the large crystals form, large crystals are brittle. Your bones would be brittle. What the body does is form nano-sized hydroxyapatite crystals in a collagen matrix that gives our bones its toughness. If the crystals get too big, you've lost that toughness in bone. And osteopontin is considered one of the primary elements to do it. So we asked, maybe osteopontin could inhibit the calcification, the mineralization of heart valves. And again, there's a lot of experiments here, but comparing no treatment, this is the calcification level on a heart valve of the type used in humans, tissue heart valve, get high calcification. And if we use one of our strategies for orienting and immobilizing the osteopontin in the correct way, we can get almost no calcification on that heart valve. So yes, the control of proteins does have a very direct relevance. Here's another interesting example of how we can control proteins by a very simple strategy. If we look at one of these antibodies, there's an FC and an FAB portion. These have different isoelectric points. They have different degrees of electrical charge at physiologic and body pH. And so if this FC portion is more negative charge, and the FAB portion is more positive charge, we put it on a positive charge surface, we should be able to orient the molecule. And this antibody, FAB, all the recognition, all the work, the good work of this antibody is happening up here. So if we can orient this up, we have a higher signal, better useful signal. So again, going to our SIMS, we can go to the protein structure data bank. We can find out the difference between the amino acids at FAB and FC in those two portions. And this kind of shows a ratio of FAB to FC. So we have some amino acids like tyrosine that are much higher in the FAB portion than the FC portion. And then we can go do an experiment. We actually taught our SIMS instrument to distinguish the FAB and the FC portion by making controls. We broke up the molecule. Then we had a self-assembled monolayer with a mean group plus charge, which should, by the hypothesized, orient the antibody this way. And then the by immobilizing it on a carboxylic acid surface, the active portion should be down. And then we did a random one, too. And sure enough, we could see the big difference between the FAB and the FC portion. And this is actually the experiment from this. It shows we can readily separate the antibody on the amine, which should have the proper groups up, or the antibody on the carboxylic acid should have the recognition groups down, or the random one comes out right in the middle. And then again, we can analyze the peaks involved here and tell exactly, are we indeed doing what we think we're doing? We could check our hypothesis out. So let's see, what is the significance of this charge sort of effect? Well, this is a slightly different experiment. It's another protein that also responds to charge in a similar way to that antibody. But what we have here are, here's an amine surface with this protein on the surface adsorbed to it. And this amine surface with the protein on it readily interacts with living cells. These are aortic endothelial cells. On the other hand, on the carboxylic acid surface, there's almost none. Now, both these surfaces, these two surfaces, have the exact same amount of this particular protein. It's a fibronectin fragment, and yet very, very different performance. And so what's going on here? Well, the cells respond to this RGD peptide unit, this recognition unit. And on the amine surface, it's up. And on the carboxylic acid surface, it's down. But the same amount of protein and totally different reactivity. This actually shows antibody binding still another system. And you can see on the carboxylic acid surface where the recognition unit is down, almost no antibody binding and very profound antibody binding on the amine surface. again, by controlling the protein with precision, we can get, and this, again, kind of illustrates that process, we can get much better bioactivity and biorecognition. So I'm going to finish up with one quick example here of still another strategy for controlling proteins and interfaces, and I call this templates. And so I have to go through this little cartoon here to show you what we did to make a template that would recognize proteins. And so we started with mica. Why did we take mica? Because it's ultra smooth. It's atomically smooth, basically. We put some proteins of interest on the mica. And then we coated it with this trail of sugar. That's the purple color here. We made a very thin coating. It's about 1 nanometer thick coating. Then we put this into a glow discharge plasma reactor and deposited a fluoropolymer Teflon-like film over that whole ensemble. Then we took this thing and glued it to a piece of glass. That's the kind of turquoise color here. Then we peeled off the mica and took out the proteins. And so as you'd imagine, there'd be pits from these proteins made into this fluoropolymer film. We asked if the pits could recognize their parent proteins. Now, what's going on here? This diagram should help. Again, we're kind of clarifying this phase in this reaction. We have this pit, remember, which is this plasma fluoropolymer film, but it was lined with sugar. And here's the template protein that organizes the sugar in that pit. So when we take away the protein, we're left with a pit lined with sugar that recognized the original protein. And so again, we brought a lot of our surface analysis tools to bear to understand what the system was. And for example, we could do the ESCA. I'm not going to go through the details, but we could, in fact, for the sake of time, I'm going to skip a lot of the interpretation of the analysis. But the ESCA tells us we have the system. We believe we have. This is called angular-dependent ESCA. Allows us to look at through the depth of the film. Here's the SIMS that tells us that when we took off all the protein, we indeed got rid of essentially all the protein. There was no protein on, only sugar left on the surface. Again, we can use this TOF SIMS to see if we look at sugar species. The sugar imprint has lots of sugar species. The immunoglobulin G imprint with elution, that means we've eluted out the protein, still has the sugar. They're both sugar. And yet the IgG imprint, the immunoglobulin imprint without the elution, we have the protein still there. Oh, let's see here. Get back here. Yeah, we have the protein still there. So it's blocking the sugar. You can't see the sugar in the SIMS. So we get, very, very excellent confirmation that we have that complicated molecular system the way we thought it was. And then we can start looking at affinity. And here's, so remember, we have a surface that's only sugar. We have no more protein recognition elements. It's made of a Teflon-like polymer, made of sugar. It's very durable. If we look at albumin adsorption, again, a lot to explain here. But the further this curve is shifted to the right, these curves are shifted to the right, the higher the affinity of those pits for albumin in competition with IgG. And so this is telling us we have at least a 10x affinity for albumin over IgG. Well, we have these albumin pits on the surface. The other protein is just not nearly as well attracted. We did two very similar sized proteins. They're both about 13 kilodaltons, so 14 kilodaltons, RNase and lysozyme. And again, we got a 20x affinity of lysozyme for that surface, of the RNase for that surface in competition with the lysozyme. So the surface was recognizing, much as happens in a biological system, but we made a very durable, hardened surface and didn't have expensive proteins in there. Show you one more example. We use another surface tool called microcontact printing, where we actually make a rubber stamp. This goes through some of the techniques to make this rubber stamp, and we can ink the stamp in, let's say, protein, and we can take that protein ink and stamp it on a surface. So this is the process here. We took that one of those stamps and stamped a protein called streptavidin onto the surface with this pattern. And so here's the stamp. We stamped it onto mica. And in these pits, just as in a rubber stamp, the streptavidin didn't stick. And then we dipped it in albumin. And the areas where there was no streptavidin, the albumin could absorb. That's the light green. And then we went through that whole templating process. We made the template. And then we absorbed proteins. And look what happened. And what did we get here? So we had a surface that had no proteins, supposedly no recognition groups, but it had those sugars in the proper order. And the streptavidin, which is the yellowish signal you're seeing here, went in the outside areas. And then if we measure with an antibody, we can see the albumin went into these circular areas. So we made a recognition surface just using sugar, using this sort of technology. How might we use this in the future? Well, kind of fantasy, but maybe we could take a hip joint, put one of these templated surfaces on it, and implant it in bone, and then it would attract the correct proteins that stimulate the healing into bone and lead us with a nicely healed device. We haven't done that yet. We're actually still working with this technology. We're doing biosensors at the moment with it, but maybe someday in the future that we could do this process. So with that, let me thank you for your attention. I think I showed some examples of how we can control these wonderful nanomachines called proteins with precision. I have to thank the UEB program, and NESEC Bio is an NIH national instrumentation resource that gives us all the high-priced gear that we bring to bear on this, and many students and staff who have contributed to this. So thank you very much.